Now we are going to the part B, third program. Let us see what is the third program. Okay, develop a program to produce payslip of an employee, name, code and designation. Develop a program to produce payslip of an employee, name, code and designation. You have to produce payslip, okay, salary slip. Okay, and another base class consisting of data members. So one base class consists of employee name, code and designation. In another base class it consists of data members such as account number, date of joining and basic pay. It also consists of some other information in some other base class, that is account number, date of joining and basic pay. The derived class consists of data members of other earnings. In the derived class it consists of other earnings, that is PF, LIC, tax, implement using interface. So this is the program related to your inheritance concept. So we have to develop this program by using interface concept. Okay, yes, so you have to give more attention from now onwards. These are the programs are very important. If you are not concentrate, you won't understand these programs. Okay, now first we are writing import java.io.star, import java.lang.star, class base emp1. So what is the name of the class? I am taking class base emp1. Okay, so here what we are doing, we are declaring one string variable. In the string variable it consists of name and designation. Name and designation data variables are defined as a string data type. Okay, and next int code, so employee code, so it is treated as an integer. Now I am constructing the constructor. This is the constructor. As we know, it is a default constructor, it doesn't consist of anything, so actually it doesn't requires. It is your wish. Employee name is equal to blank, designation is equal to blank, code is equal to 0. And now I am writing one more constructor. This is the constructor with arguments string e. E stands for employee name, d stands for string d, d stands for designation, int c stands for code. Okay, employee name I am assigning as e parameter, designation I am assigning d parameter, code c I am assigning C parameter. Okay, yes, this is the constructor with arguments. Okay, now I am displaying one more method I am writing. What is the name of the method? Disp base one. Disp base one is the method. It is a return type is void, and I am displaying the output as name is emp name, output designation as a designation, system dot 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 printl, and code as code. So here it comes the end of one base class, one class. What is the name of the class ends here? Base emp1. And now I am taking interface. Interface is also like a class where it consists of final fields and final methods, right? It doesn't consist any implementation part, right? Yes, let us see. Here I am declaring int account number is equal to 1200. It is fixed, it doesn't changes. String, I am taking string as joining date variable. What is the variable name? Join underscore date is a string variable, and I am assigning as 88 2008. That should be specified in double quotation. And next I am specifying int basic. Basic salary, basic salary is 14,000. So here the interface ends. That's it. I am not doing anything. I am just initialized this account number, string joining date, int basic. Now I am writing one more class. What is the name of the class? Class DerivEMP. Please observe here, this is the child class. DerivEMP is the child class. Extends, extends means it is inheriting. Which class it is inheriting? Base EMP1. Implements, implements means it is also inheriting. Implements means it is also inheriting. Yes, now we are writing one more class. What is the name of the class I am writing? DerivEMP. Deriv EMP. Okay, it is extends. Extends means it is inheriting. Which class it is inheriting? Base EMP1. In the base EMP1, what does it consist of? Employee name, designation, code, right? And you are displaying that. And implements, what is the meaning of implements? You are inheriting the interface. Okay, you are inheriting which concept? Interface. What is the name of the interface you are inheriting? Base EMP2. This consists of account number, joining date and basic, right? So this DerivEMP class inherits base EMP1 and also base EMP2. It inherits the base EMP1 class and base EMP2 inheritance. Okay, in here derived class I am specifying some variables. We have to calculate other information. For that, I am taking int DA. DA, HRA, CCA, LIC, DF, and tax. So your daily allowance, house rent allowance. This is some CCA and LIC, provident fund, and tax. Okay, these are the variables. Now I am writing one method. Here the condition is not given. You can give any your condition. So I am taking one method. The name of the method is int earning. Int is its return type as integer and earnings. Okay, whoever call this method, it will return some value. Please observe here DA. I am calculating the DA. How to calculate the DA? Basic into 15%. Basic into 15/100. I am calculating the 15% of basic as DA, and next you are calculating the HRA basic into 10%, 10/100. Okay, you are calculating the HRA and CCA basic into 8/100. 8% of basic you are calculating as a CCA, and whoever calling this earning, it will return DA plus HRA plus CCA. So what it will return? DA plus HRA plus CCA. This is the earning. Okay, now I am writing one more method for the deduction. So we have to deduct for provident fund. I am provident fund through it will be deducted from the basic into 10%. So I am deducting it from the basic value as a 10%, and it will be stored in PF. And I am processing LIC basic into 12/100, 12%. So LIC is calculating as the 12% of the basic, and it will be stored in LIC. And tax is of a basic. For the basic, it is calculating as the 15%. Okay, so 15% of tax throw from the basic is calculated, and it will be stored in your tax. And now it is returning. Whoever calling this deduction method, it will return PF plus LIC plus tax. This should be deducted from your earnings. Okay, your earnings. Now I am writing one more method, that is a void payslip. What is the method I am writing? Void payslip. So first, if you print, you have to calculate the gross. So how to calculate the gross? Basic plus earnings minus deduction. So what is your basic salary plus whatever the earnings you are earning minus your deduction, then you are getting your gross. Got it? So as you know, these are the formulas you have learned from your first year to final year. This is the formula you are doing. Now you are calculating the gross. Gross is basic plus earnings. Earnings, it consists of DA, HRA, CCA total minus deduction. We have to deduct PF, LIC tax from these. Then we will get gross salary. Afterwards, I am displaying output as statement as payslip. System.out.println a blank space, and you are displaying the DA. It will show DA value. It will display the HRA. I am displaying system.out.println, HRA will be displayed. I am displaying PF, PF will be displayed, LIC will be displayed, tax will be displayed, CCA will be displayed, and gross is also displayed. Okay, yes. Now I am writing here, please observe here, actually this method should become front. This is the constructor. Why? Because in the base classes you are having the constructors, so through from child it has to be initialized, right? So what is the name of the class here? Derive EMP. In the derive EMP, you are passing name, designation, and code. Okay, these three values should be initialized in your base class constructor, that is base EMP1. So to pass the value of a base class constructor, we have to use a super method. What is the purpose of super method? To pass the base class constructor to pass the base class value to the through from the child class, right? Yes. So it will initialize base class constructor, name of the person, designation of the person, and code of the person, right? And now I am displaying public void display base 2. Here one more method I am taking in the same class. I am displaying the employee information, please observe here, disp base 1 means you are calling employee name, employee code, and these will be accessible here. And afterwards you are displaying the joining date, account number, basic. Okay, so if you call the payslip, it will display this payslip values. Okay, So after displaying name of the employee, code and designation, next you are displaying the joining date, account number, basic. Afterwards you are calling the payslip, it will display the payslip. Okay, so here derive emp also ends in this class, also doesn't have any main method. Now I am writing the main method. The name of the class is employee, and I am writing the main method. In the main method I am writing try catch block. Here I have not used the rows IO exception. Instead of that I am writing try catch block. Okay, in the try block I am writing what are the variables we require. And is fine. String name is required, designation is required, code is required. Afterwards, you are creating the input object. Input object. What is the name of the input object? Here EMP, data input stream, EMP. Okay. So you are created the input object as EMP. Now you are displaying one output statement. Enter the name of the employee. So you have to read the value from the keyboard. Employee name is a string. So EMP dot read line, and you are storing name. If you are getting a confusion, then you can assign it as a db. Okay, db dot read line. Okay, next we have to enter the designation. So if you want to read the value from the keyboard, we have to use the read line method, but designation is also string, hence it doesn't read any conversion. Whatever the value you are readed and you are going to be storing in the variable designation. And next enter the code. You are displaying one output statement. Enter the code. So we have to enter the value from the code, that is for example 123, that is the code we have to enter. It is an integer, but it is not supposed to store as a string. So you are forcefully converting that 123 string into integer and stored in the variable code. Now for the child class you are creating the object. What is the child class? Derive emp. For derive emp you are taking the object d is equal to new derive emp of, and you are passing name, designation, code. Why? Because in your child class it consists of a constructor, and child class through base class constructor should be initialized. That is why we have passed the values from the keyboard. While creating we are supplying these values, okay, because the constructor should be initialized, right? Now you are calling d dot display base 2. So d is the object of derived class, and you are calling this method. What is the method you are calling? Display base 2. Whenever you call this method, display base 1 will be called. Display base 1 will be present in your base class, that is employee name, designation, code. It will be automatically initialized. Afterwards it will display this joining date, account number and basic. Afterwards payslips, it will call the payslip, and basic plus earnings, it will call earnings will be executed, deduction will be executed, and it will be stored gross, and it will be displayed. Okay, so after that if any error is exist in this try block, it will be catched by the catch block. Okay, and here it comes the end of your program. If you compile and run your program, you are entering Rajini designation as enter engineer code as 345. It will display the employee information as this. Okay, let me show you the execution of this program. I will open my third program, edit with notepad, right? Let me save it. How to save this file? This file should be saved with employee, right? Because employee consists of a main method. I'm copying and file, save as. While saving, you have to ensure that you are storing in JDK 1.4 bin folder. employee.java. Okay, so now I am opening my command prompt. Let me clear the screen. CLS java c employee.java. So there is no error. Java employee, it is asking for the name of the employee. I am giving smc dca. Enter the designation, lecturer. Next code is 1456. Okay, if I enter that, it will be calculated and it will be displayed this information. So this is your third program in your part B. So you have to give more attention on these programs. If you go through best practices, then this can be very, very easy. Okay, hope you understand this concept. If you have any queries, please put me. So this is about your third program, and we will continue our fourth program. What is the fourth program? Let us see. Program to demonstrate multi-threading using runnable interface. So runnable interface, multi-threading concept. Okay, define three different threads, one to calculate square of first n integers, another to calculate cube of first n integers, and third thread to find square root of the first n integers. Apply various thread priority. So this is your fourth program. Let us see what is the fourth program we'll do. Already we have explained about the threads, right? So this is a multi-thread concept. Let us give more attention on this. First, I am writing import java.lang.store, and now we are writing the class. What is the name of the class? Square. Square extends thread. So it is inheriting the concept of thread. Okay. Here first I am directly writing public void run method. In the run method, we have to calculate one interface for one for first n number, square of first n numbers. It is for square. That is why we are taken as a square. Okay. For doing the square, we have to declare the variable I, j, n is equal to 5. I is equal to 1, j is equal to 1, n is equal to 5. We are initializing n value up to 5. Okay. I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 5. Condition is true. If true, it will enter into the block. J is equal to 1 into 1. The square of 1 is 1. The square of 1 is 1. Right. It will display. And next, it will come to the I incrementation. It becomes 2. 2 less than or equal to 5. Condition is true. 2 into 2, 4. Square of 2 is 4. Square of 3 is 9, square of 4 is 16, square of 5 is 25. Till that it will continue. For example, here we are giving if j less than or equal to 3. If j value is less than or equal to 3, at that time it has to yield. Yield means you are making wait. What is the purpose of yield method? You are making wait. Okay. And next. So here it comes the end of your first program. First class, and we are writing the next class. What is the next class I am writing? Cube. Class cube extends threads. Extend thread. Okay. So it is also inheriting the thread concept. I am writing the same public void run method. I am taking the same for loop for the cube. We are taking I comma j is equal to 1, n is equal to 5 up to 5. 1 into 1 into 1. Cube of 1 is 1. Cube of 2 is equal to 8. Cube of 3 is equal to 27. Cube of 4 is equal to so and so, it will be displayed. But here you are giving j less than or equal to 3. If j less than or equal to 3, you are temporarily stopping. Okay, you are temporarily stopping, right? And next, here it comes the end of your cube class. Okay, then how long it will be executed? It will execute only one. Now let us see. I am writing one more class, class square root. We have to identify the square root. Extends the thread. It is also inheriting the thread concept. Now you are writing public void run method. Here the run method is exist. In the run method, what you are doing? You are declaring the variable int I comma n is equal to 5. So I 5 is taken, and here we are taking as double value as j. Variable j is declared as double. Now you are writing for loop. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 5. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 5. Condition true. If condition is true, let us come here. J is equal to math.sqrt. Math.sqrt. So math.sqrt is the built-in function. By using this built-in function, it will identify the square root of 1. Afterwards, you are displaying that value. Square root of 1 is whatever the value it may be, it will display. If it condition is less than or equal to 3, j value is less than or equal to 3, it will sleep in try catch block. I am writing sleep method. By using this sleep method, you are making waiting of this thread. So this thread will be wait for 1 second, I think so. Okay, 1 second it will be wait. If any error has occurred, it will be catch by the catch block. Okay, so here it comes the end of this class cube. Class square root. Okay, so in about three classes we do not have any main method. Now I am writing one more class. What is the class? Priority one. In this class it consists of a main method. Now you are writing this variable square sq is equal to new square of. Square sq is equal to new square of. For square class you are creating the object. The name of the object is sq. For cube class, you are creating the object. The name of the object is CN. For the square root class, you are creating the object. The name of the object is SQR. Okay. So next, you are setting the priority. SQ dot set priority. SQ square object dot set priority. Thread dot minimum priority. For square class, you are setting the minimum priority. For cube class, you are setting the priority as a norm priority. So for square root class, you are setting the priority as max priority. According to the priority setting, it has to execute square root first and cube second and last square, right? But we do not know whenever we start our thread, it may, according to the starting of our thread, it may execute and it will reach these conditions. According to this condition, it will be evaluate. Okay. And whenever you run this program, first cube is evaluating, square is next, square. I do not know actually how it is a square has come, right? Okay. Afterwards, it is coming as in a square root. What is the priority for your square root? Max priority. Okay. So it is showing like this. Let us see whether it will work or not. Let me copy fourth program. Let me edit. So this is our fourth program. Let me, what is the name of a program to store, copy it and file, save as, and ensure that where you have to supposed to save, JDK 1.4 bin and priority 1.java. okay, now I'm opening my editor and clear the screen. Now compile it. Java C priority 1.java. So it is a consist of illegal start of expression. Here it is in the line number 51 and 41. Actually it doesn't requires. We can delete this. Okay. Yes. It is also not required. Remove this condition. That's it. Here it starts, here it ends. Here it starts, here it ends. Okay. And here it starts and here it ends. Now it is fine. Save it. Actually doesn't requires. Please observe, this condition is not there, and here also the condition is not required. So please observe here in your program, whatever the condition is here specified, yield method and what are the stop method, it doesn't requires. Remove this. You just remove this. You just remove this yield method. This condition is not required. This is also not required. Remove it. And this is also not required. Remove it. Okay, you just remove till here. Okay, now after that, let me compile once again. Yes, there is no error. Now run your program. Java priority 1. If you run this, you are getting queue first because highest priority, normal priority first, it is having queue, next square. It is according to the not priority. It, even though if it is not in the priority, it is executing. So once again, if you run this, it will changes. Okay, if you run this, it will changes. You don't expect the same output. Whatever the output may be, fine. Okay, yes. So it is giving your output. Hope you understand this concept. We will meet in next class.